हरे कृष्ण प्रभु जी, मुझे प्रणाम।
हरे कृष्ण प्रभु जी, दोनों प्रणाम।
We'll start. Om Agantyamandasya Gyananjana Shalakya Chakshuramitamena Tasmay Sri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manovishtam Saptam Yen Bhutale Shanandrupadamayam Dadat Sapanandram Vandeham Shri Guru Oshiyotapada Kamalam Shri Guru Nveshnavamsta Shri Upam Sagarjatam Saganaravanatam Tantam Sajivam Sadvitam Savadutam Parjana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Saganamalita Shri Shakamatamsta नमो विष्णु पादाय कृष्ण प्रसाद भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति विलास सांतराम ने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी चाणी निर्विशेष सुनवाणी पाशा देस्थान ने वांछा कल्प दुर्वेशा के पास दुर्वेशा पतिता नाम पाव ने देव वैष्णव देव नमो नम नमो महावदनाय कृष्ण प्रेम पदाय जय कृष्ण हरे कृष्ण चैतन्य नाम ने वर्त से नम हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीन बंधु जगपते गोत्सा गोपुर अंतर राधा कंतर मुस्ते सप्तकांचन गौरांगी सीता देवंदवनी शरीर सवानु सुप्रिय देवी पुनमामी हरि प्रिय परमात्मा ने बल भद्र शोभद्राभ्याम जगन्नाथ है के नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवसद गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे। हरे कृष्ण। सो नेक्स्ट ग्रुप्स आर रेडी फॉर द प्रेजेंटेशन। So, which groups were supposed to present today?
Twenty is also supposed to do, Prabhu. Mine is, ours is 20. And
20, 21, 22.
20, 21, 22. Na? So, 20, whose is 20?
Who is Prabhuji? Ramya and Trisha Mataji. Ramya.
Okay. Co-host now, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. If only the files are not showing. Give me 1 second, Prabhu. Can you all see?
Yes, Mother.
Okay, Prabhuji. So today our topic is on... I first take all your blessings and mercy. So I go through this pretty well. So let us start. Our discussion is going to be on the relevance of our own practice on Krishna consciousness. And Krishna's analysis of charity. What does he speak about charity in different modes of nature? So let us walk through our current existing practices, what we do on Krishna consciousness. So in this chapter, Lord speaks only about... five items, which is a faith, food, sacrifices, austerity, and charity. So I'm basically focusing only on the mode of goodness and our practice, which will be the transcendental state. So when we speak about faith, usually in mode of goodness, everybody does demigod worship, and they have, having any sort of faith on demigod worship is considered to be mode of goodness. And this completely purifies the material modes, and it transcends us to attain the level of Brahman. But when you speak about Srila Prabhupada is, he always believes in putting us in a transcendental state. He does not believe in any elementary state or, going gradually. He straight away picks us up, puts us in a transcendental state. So from there, whether we hold it tight or whether it is left to our free will, sankalpa, sadhana, whether we go up or not. So He does not put us in any material mode at all. So he straight away practices us from the transcendental mode. Anywhere where we speak about Krishna, it becomes transcendental. Activities, it becomes transcendental. So to illustrate it, it is Sattvam Vishuddham Vasudeva Sabditam. What is Sattvam? Sattvam is goodness. Vishuddham is worship. Vasudeva Sabditam is celebration. So if you speak about when man is situated in pure goodness, he worships Vasudeva. So we all worship Vasudeva. So we are basically pretty much on a decent level on a goodness mode. But from there, we convert ourselves to the transcendental mode, you know, a complete pure goodness state. So in this state, what do we do? What do we get? You know, we regain our relationship with the Lord, which will purify us from within, internally and externally. And this is definite. It is a guaranteed path of perfection, Krishna consciousness. So that is our practice. So Trisha Masterji, would you like to do the food slide?
Hare Krishna. Like food, in the translation, if you see, it is written, you have to eat whatever is cooked within 3 hours of the time. But many a times it happens that we tend to cook and keep it for long and maybe eat the next day many a times. But it is not a good practice. I have actually seen in one of our neighbors that the lady, she used to cook in the evenings and mornings twice a day, and they would eat on time. Like if it is cooked in the evening, then within 7:30 the eating would be over, and by 8 o'clock, 9, they used to go to sleep. So that is actually a practice of in the mode of goodness. But when it comes to Krishna Prasad, we say because it is offered to the Lord, it is okay to be, because it is completely purified, we say it is okay to be eaten even the next day. But sometimes out of laziness, maybe what we try to do is we try to cook next day, and again the previous day and the next day we try to, you know, pack it up and eat it. So it is not actually a good practice. So Krishna Prasad is transcendental, and such remnants, they are offered to the Lord. So it illuminates our mouth and the outlet evacuation. It also purifies our senses and naturally positioning in the mode of goodness. So now Ramya Mataji will continue.
So basically, we should ensure that although it is Krishna Prasad, we should try not to be lazy, cook it on time, eat on time, and have the prana go into our body on time. So now we speak about sacrifices. See, sacrifices, right from Satya Yuga, we have been having various kinds of sacrifices, as you all may know. Initially, it was tapa. They used to do tapa, and then it became yajnas, and then it became temple worship. And now we are in a stage we don't know anything. So basically, even now we see a lot of people doing this homa, that homa, and the various other yajnas. You know, now there is no Brahman who can do a proper yajna, who can do the proper. You never know whether you're going to incur a sin by doing it, because if you doesn't do it in a proper way, you're not going to get anything out of it. Rather, you might end up getting a bad karma as well. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has been very, very kind to us, that he says, do a very simple yajna, just 2 lines of yajna, you know, just always do this yajna, and this purifies us and puts us in a transcendental stage. And he has, of course, he has promised us, by doing this yajna without fail every day, upon completion of 12 years, he said he would be physically be present to pick us up to his abode. So that is what is this yajna's, this nama sankirtana, sankirtana yajna's speciality is. And apart from that, yeah, reading scriptures puts us in our practice. We have to be doing this reading scriptures. Then visiting temples for the purification, and we should desire no reward. We should desire no reward. It should only be for the pleasure of the Lord. Then we should be chanting our prescribed nouns without fail. And then we speak about austerity. So what is austerity? Austerity is not just chanting our rounds. It's austerity is by body, by speech, and by mind. So what is by body? Cleanliness, celibacy, and non-violence. You should never be thinking non-violence even mentally. So that comes as austerity in the mind. Then speech. We have this habit, like four or five of us, even in devotee circle, it happens. Four or five of us sit together. What we do? We end up gossiping sometimes, or, you know, we like to talk, you know, mouth likes to talk. As long as the tongue is there and the mouth is there, we like to talk. So rather we try and focus it on talking about the glories of the Lord and, you know, not talk words which are not agitating. So basically this falls under the speech of mode of goodness. But when we speak about Krishna conscious speech, it be speaking about glories of the Lord. This takes us to the transcendental mode, because Krishna already sits there. So all we have to do is travel to his place. The moment we talk about him, we are sitting in his place. So detached from sense gratification and staying fixed on Krishna consciousness, and by following the four regulative principles at the basic level, we are already in a transcendental stage. Then we speak about charity. So here, Krishna's illustration on charity is that, first of all, charity will purify our heart and it will detach us from the material things and purifies our accumulated wealth. So, you know, in olden days, like our parents or our grandparents, what they used to do, they used to do charity out of duty and at the proper time and place. For example, when we have our birthdays, my mom, whenever I used to have my birthday, she has the habit of, you know, donating to the temple, like, you know, there'll be this big hundi where she just puts money for annadana or something. So this has been a practice in almost most of the families. This is what they practice out of duty, but without knowing the philosophy behind it. But now we know the philosophy of giving it as a Krishna prasad. So basically you need to give it to a proper time and proper place to a worthy person. So that is what is in the mode of goodness. But what are we doing in Krishna conscious? What do we do? Like, you know, for the construction of the temple or sponsoring the festivals, then Goseva and distribution of the books and, you know, distribution of prasad and, you know, helping the Gurukul to, you know, elucidate the scriptural learning for all the kids. And enlightening basically the society, you know, because when the young learns the right thing, the entire world becomes peaceful and blissful. So this is what we do in Krishna consciousness, in the mode of pure goodness. And what are we not supposed to do? When you do a charity, we are not supposed to be expecting anything from in return. Then we should not desire for fruitive results. Never do anything on a grudging mode. Like, we give it. And especially the charity and repentance, we give it and they say, oh my God, why did I do it? You know, I've spent so much of money. So such thoughts should never come. The moment it comes, then there is no charity involved in it. And charitable foundations, giving it to charitable foundations, like, for example, sorry for the mixer sound. Charitable foundations, basically, there are people who usually give to Christian missionaries. You know, even I used to do that earlier, because there used to be a Christian missionary which is beside my house. So there are a lot of orphan kids. So I used to feel like, you know, those kids deserve to have good food. So I used to actually give it to them on any special occasions. And the realization came only today that has been in the mode of passion, because sometimes whatever the money that we give, they do give non-veg, you know that, right, in Christian missionary. So we also incur sins. At the same time, we also, although we are trying to do it as a helping to the charitable institutions, it is all a sense gratification that they're giving, you know, on a food. So basically, in mode of goodness, we just only distribute Krishna prasad and follow strictly the rules and regulative principles set by Srila Prabhupada. And now Trisha Mataji is now trying to put this entire chapter in her own words of paraphrasing into a small synopsis. So, yeah. Trisha Mataji?
Hare Krishna. Yeah. The title of this we have given is That's the Mode. So it is demigod worship to Brahma, Shiva and others, food for life, strength and health, satisfying and pleasing to heart, sacrifice as per scriptures, out of duty, or no desire for reward. That's the mode of goodness. But when Krishna, when goodness becomes Krishna conscience, that's the stage of pure goodness. Worshipping demigods, Hitlers of the modern world, austerity and penance, for pride they undergo. In lust and attachment they are impelled, torturing body and soul. They are foolish, we know. Bitter, salty, pungent and dry. These are the food passionate ones enjoy. Sacrifice for material benefit and pride. They are passionate fools in Krishna's eyes. Worshippers of ghost and spirit, tasteless, decomposed, putrid, are not right. Ignorant people only eat these bites. Sexual service in the name of God is in mode of darkness. Low class and ignorant ones only follow superstition. Directionless sacrifice and priests lead society to ignorance. So this is a small poem we tried to make. Hare Krishna. Unmute yourself.
So they gave nice presentation as well as wrote a very powerful poem. Maybe Mata, you can also give it in BTG. I'm sure it will get published. So we'd like to thank all these devotees by 3 times chanting. Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. So now group number 21. Group number 21?
Yes, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. Can you please give the share screen?
Yes, Mata. Okay. Can you tell whom you are supposed to make the host?
Kalpana.
Oh, Kalpana. Yes, Mata, you are the host now.
Thank you.
Is everyone able to see the presentation? Hare Krishna.
Mataji. Yes, Mataji.
Yeah. Pranams to all assembled devotees. I seek all your blessings so that I could present this presentation in right mode. We are given the topic, discuss appropriate and inappropriate charity with reference to Bhagavad Gita verse 17.20 to 17.22. It comes under the chapter of divisions of faith. Here Krishna explains about various people according to their different modes of nature, develop a faith, and according to that they perform the charity, which is specially in the mode of goodness, in the mode of passion, and in the mode of ignorance. But first of all, we need to understand why we give this charity, what is the importance behind it as per the scriptural injections. So Krishna says in verse number 9.27, whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever you offer, give away, and whatever austerities you perform, do that, O son of Kunti, as an offering to me. Everyone has a tendency to give something in charity. Krishna says, give it to me. Srila Prabhupada says, it is a duty of every living being to perform welfare activities for the benefit of others with his wealth, life, wealth, intelligence, and words. It actually purifies the soul. Krishna emphasizes charity in different chapters, especially in chapter number 4. He explains about different varieties of charities. In chapter number 10, he says charity as the origin itself comes from Krishna. And in chapter number 16, he says charity is one of the transcendental quality. So it is a necessity for everyone to cultivate the attitude of charity. So through these verses, we will see what is appropriate and inappropriate charity through 3 modes of nature. So first, I'll proceed with appropriate charity, and Nandi Mukhi Mataji will say about inappropriate charity. So the appropriate charity, which is in the mode of goodness. So it goes, Datavyam iti yaddhanam dhiyate anupakarine deshe kale cha patre cha taddhanam sattvikam smritam. Charity given out of duty without expectation of return at the proper time and place to a worthy person is considered to be in the mode of goodness. So it is necessary to consider all these below factors, that is anupakarine. It is irrespective of return. It has to be done as a due sense of duty, because it was practiced in the olden days, as especially in Hindus, whenever there is an occasion, they give it as to help, especially when they give, it is followed in the slide also, you can see when they give birth to a son, Nand Maharaj. So how he has given in charity thousands of cows. So this was a custom which was followed without any return. They used to help the poor and to the Brahmanas, they used to give in charity. So it was a duty, which is always considered as a spiritual perfection. So that was the main, this thing behind it, in this aim of, in the mode of goodness, people usually focus on spiritual perfection. So in order to do that, they take as a right, proper place and proper time, usually in temples, at a holy place, pilgrimage. People even focus on lunar and solar eclipse, because these moments are considered to be very auspicious, and it brings auspicious to the person who gives them. And especially if you see in the Shastras, Advaita Acharya, he had given in the appearance of Lord Chaitanya, it was a lunar eclipse. People were thinking why he was giving so much of charity. People might be thinking it's a lunar eclipse. Of course, it was for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's appearance. But people take maximum benefits on these days for spiritual cause. Patre, to a suitable, worthy person, for a braga, maybe a qualified Brahmana or a Vaishnava or a devotee. So why it is mentioned here is, in Garuda Puran, it is mentioned the person whom you are giving can accept the gifts only he gives protector to the giver through his knowledge and austerity. So a Brahmana, if you see, he doesn't keep this for his own self-interest. He will distribute that money in charity, or he will utilize for the spiritual, in spreading the Vedic teachings. So even Srila Prabhupada says, a Brahmana, even if he gets 1 lakh rupees, 100,000 rupees, still he is a beggar, because he will not keep it. He will immediately distribute in charity. Same way, if you go for a Vaishnava, definitely a Vaishnava utilizes for the cause of Krishna consciousness. He says, Srila Prabhupada says, in that context also, if you build a temple of Krishna consciousness in this world, he will build a palace for you in the spiritual world, Vaikuntha. So Vaishnava will always utilize for a preaching purpose, for all the spiritual activities, focusing on Krishna as a center. He will use it for distributing prasadam. He will utilize it for the building temples. There are so many varieties of devotional service which is focused for the pleasure of Krishna. So in the mode of goodness, what the Vedic literature says about it, it recommends charity for spiritual activities. Here it is mentioned as indiscriminate charity is not recommended. Now what do you mean by this indiscriminate is, suppose you're helping a poor person out of compassion. Suppose you're helping a poor lady who you feel who is worthy to give. So if you give them, if the money is utilized by his husband for his own sensual, he is abusing it, or he is using for his own drinking purpose or something, that will incur something. You should give such a kind of charity which cannot be replaced also. Suppose like clothes or food, this cannot be replaced and will not be utilized for a wrong purpose. So that is also, though, such indiscriminate charity is not recommended. So only through modes of goodness one can transcend the three modes of nature. So this is very well done in Krishna consciousness. One acting, basically as Prabhuji last class also explained, one, even a devotee, even though they are performing transcendental activities, but they need to develop the quality of goodness so that it gradually they will go to a pure goodness state, and it purifies their contaminated mind. One acting in Krishna consciousness execute the most appropriate, it is considered to be the topmost charity, through preaching and engaging others in devotional service, thus elevating to a spiritual consciousness, which is a prime necessity for the suffering mankind. Even in Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th canto, 8th chapter, 10th verse, it says, it is impossible to improve people's material conditions. Material conditions are already established by the superior administration according to one's karma. They cannot be changed. The only benefit we can render to suffering beings is to try to raise them to spiritual consciousness. So I'll hand it over to Nandimukhi Mataji. She'll be explaining about the mode of passion and ignorance. Yes, Mataji, you can take over.
Hare Krishna. Can you hear, Mataji?
Yes.
So, in the verse 17.21 describes a mode of passion. Charity that is performed with the expectation of some return or with a classic full fruitive results or in a grudging mode is said to be in the mode of passion. So, sometimes charity is given out of social pressure or because maybe the husband is not inclined to give charity and the wife forces him to give. So, he just gives it out of grudge or reluctantly. So, such charity, the intention will not be good and the intention is the most important thing. So, if such a person gives charity, then no one is benefited. Even the person who's giving will not benefit and the person who receives also will not benefit. So, they even expect some material benefit from that. Oh, maybe if I give this, I will get more money if I give to this demigod or something like that. So, they are expecting more money and more material things when they give charity. So, this kind of charity comes in the mode of passion. And also, sometimes many people give charity to clubs and other things. Many lakhs and lakhs of rupees they give. And in clubs and all, they use it only for drinking and eating non-veg. And such kind of charity is not appropriate. So that comes in the mode of passion. So, Mati, next slide. So Vedic literature recommends charity utilized for sense gratification is not recommended. Now, mode of ignorance, charity performed at an impure place, at an improper time to unworthy persons or without proper attention and respect is said to be in the mode of ignorance. So, in the mode of ignorance, they don't consider any proper time, place or anything. Like, for example, a beggar, sometimes we see when we go out and, you know, many people give to a poor beggar, seeing his hand. Money. But we don't know that, later he will go and smoke and he will smoke or drink and, do whatever he likes. So this kind of charity is called in the mode of ignorance, which does not elevate, it harms him also and it gives bad result to us also. So it is not an auspicious one to give. And the whole idea of charity is not that we are giving, to this person. It's like whatever we have got it from Krishna, we are giving it to others. So it's not that we should make others beg for us to give charity. Many people who are wealthy, they just want the others to come and beg for them. They don't just give it until they are their false ego is increased. They want others to. So such kind of charity is in the mode of ignorance, and usually charity should be given out of respect for the other person, though he might be from a poor background or his condition is not good. Still, it should be given out of respect for them. So, such kind of charity comes in the mode of ignorance. And Vedic literature says, contribution for indulgence in intoxication and gambling are not encouraged, which ultimately...
Mataji, it is stuck. We are not able to hear you.
Haribol?
Yes, yes.
So, yeah, Mataji, you can continue.
Yeah. So we understand that through a mode of passion and ignorance, how people, the intention easily, here we can come to know the intention behind it, especially in mode of passion. If you see the politicians, they keep on doing some charity in the name of, so that in return they get some votings and they could stand in the elections. Or you can see in all the festivals that you celebrate in metropolitan cities that they invest so much of money in getting an idol of Lord Ganesha for the festival, just for the show of. There's big things have been, big idols are worshipped, but there is no devotion left in that. People play film music, or they ultimately the money is utilized, and the end of the last day they utilize in intoxication and everything. So it is, should be used. The intention is very main in this passion. So that's what it is not recommended, because without it has to be performed as a duty, and our mood is very important before performing any charity. So I would like to conclude the session by giving the quote from Bhagavatam. So it says in Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakura in Bhagavatam 12th canto, it is mentioned, this charity is one of the pillars, four pillars of dharma, instead of cleanliness. In that verse, he says, along with truthfulness, mercy and austerity, charity is also one of the pillars. Actual charity here referred to as dhanam. It is to award fearlessness and freedom to others, and not to give them some material means of temporary pleasure or relief. Thus only realization of one's eternal existence beyond reach of time can make one fearless, and only freedom from material desire constitutes real freedom, for it enables one to escape the bondage of the laws of nature. Therefore, real charity is to help revive their eternal spiritual consciousness. Srila Prabhupada said, charity is in everyone's heart. Charity should only be given to propagate Krishna consciousness all over the world. That is a charity in the mode of goodness. Thank you. I would like to end the session. Hare Krishna.
I'd like to thank this group by three times chanting. Hare Bol, Hare Bol, Hare Bol. Now, group number 22.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Pranam Prabhuji.
Yes,
please allow me to share. Vimalini Mataji.
Yes, Mataji, you can share now.
Okay, thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna Prabhuji and all assembled devotees, please accept our humble, respectful obeisance under your lotus feet. We are seeking all your blessings, prayers for doing the presentation properly. And if any mistake happens, please forgive us and correct us. Her Grace Shubhangi Gaurapriya Mataji and I, we are in group 22. Our topic is to discuss Srimad Bhagavad Gita as it is chapter 18, verse from 19 to 40. The question is to discuss the relevance of for your own practice of Krishna consciousness, Krishna's analysis of knowledge, action, understanding, determination, and happiness in the modes. So in Bhagavad Gita, 18.19 speaks about how the modes control our activities related to knowledge, action, understanding, determination, and happiness. So first, we are going to knowledge in three modes. So modes, we have three types: goodness, passion, and ignorance. In Bhagavad Gita 18.20, goodness explains that knowledge by which that undivided spiritual nature is seen in all the living entities, though they are divided into innumerable forms. That is, a person who sees one spirit soul in every living being, whether a demigod, human being, animal, bird, or plant, possessing the mode of knowledge. So next is 18.21 explains knowledge in passion. That knowledge by which one sees in every different body, there is different type of living entity. Example, the concept that the material body is entity, and with the destruction of the body because of development of different types of consciousness. There is no separate soul. Body itself is consciousness, is temporary. This is the type of work without knowledge of truth. Which is example of the man, knowledge of the body. He does not think good or bad, or what is right, what is wrong. So this person will kill the innocent people for getting his own pleasure. So they are thinking earning money is more pleasure. So there is no connection with absolute truth. They are thinking like knowledge of ordinary animals. So next, Shanti Mataji, you can continue, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, please, I offer my respectful, humble obeisances to each and every one of you. Thank you, Vimalini Mataji. Can you just change the slide? Hare Bol. Hare Krishna, Mataji, can you please change the slide?
Three kinds of actions.
Yeah. So I will speak about three kinds of actions. Yeah. Thank you. I will speak about three kinds of actions. Same, three modes. Actions and mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. So action in the mode of goodness is an activity which is performed without attachment and without desire for fruitive results. And it is done for pleasing the Supreme Lord. Passion, it is done for seeking one's own pleasure. Whichever increases my own pleasure, those actions I will do. And ignorance, it neither gives happiness for myself nor for others. It is exactly opposite of what is mentioned in the scriptures. Now, this is a general description that is given in Bhagavad Gita. But generally, I did not understand. When I read through this, I couldn't find out where I was standing and what kind of action I am doing. So I'll give a practical example of each. This is for us to understand where we are standing. Suppose a person comes and blasphemes me or hits me, slaps me, for example. How do I react? My action, if I think for a few seconds, is he an elderly person who is trying to correct my actions? Is he my friend who is trying to advise me not to do something? Or is he an intoxicated person or a mafia gang who's come to attack me? So based on what I see, this all happens within my mind within nanoseconds. The intelligence discriminates what is the right action and what is not. And then I decide my action. So if I think before I reflect, then I'm in the mode of goodness. The same scenario, if before the person takes out the hand from my cheek, after slapping, I'm saying, if I'm hitting him back four times more, then it is in the mode of passion. Then I will see, oh Krishna, I shouldn't have done like this. He was my best friend. He told me for my own good. Why did I do like this? Why did I do? So that guilt feeling is carried later. So that is in the mode of passion. Sometimes we react and then we think. So that is in the mode of passion. And in the mode of ignorance, what happens? The person neither understands that he has been beaten up, nor he reacts. What happens? Prabhuji actually said a very good example of a student who was beaten black and blue. He did not understand that day that he has been beaten. So that is in the mode of ignorance. Oftentimes we think, okay, we are safe. I come under any of this category, goodness or passion. And ignorance is not to me. We feel very happy, but that is not the case. There is another phase of action in ignorance that we, I think many of us, I do not know about you all, but I have been doing it. Suppose an employee scolds an employer, okay, in the office. The employee returns home and he shows his anger, which was due to that employer, on his wife and children. Suppose as a wife, if my mother-in-law or sister-in-law or any of my husband's relatives say some harsh words to me or behave indifferently to me, I cannot react to them. So what do? I react to my children. Without any reason, I beat my children. So these are all acts under ignorance, which means that I take the action somewhere and give my reaction elsewhere. My action taking and reaction giving is totally unrelated. So in that way, that is also an action in ignorance. So now we can judge ourselves in which action we are in. So if we think before we act, then we are in goodness. If we act and then think, we are in passion. There is no relation to what we, what action we got and what reaction we give. That is in ignorance. So, Vimalini Mataji, can you just change the slide? So now we will speak about workers in three modes. So the worker in the mode of goodness and passion and ignorance. So first I will speak about the worker in the mode of ignorance. Who are they? These people, they do not care for spiritual injunctions. They are grossly materialistic and they do not have any tinge of guilt in harming others also. Say for example, these workers are the sex workers, and then mafia gangs, and then those who do this religious fights in the name of jihad or something else. And then those who are corrupting the whole garment, they all come under the mode of ignorance. Meaning to say, neither are they happy, nor are the others happy. In the sense, they think that they are controlling the entire universe. Say for example, a sharpshooter or an mafia gang, they think everybody is under their control. But just before this this presentation, there was a presentation in the charity. They said beggars were spoken of. These people are royal beggars. Okay, they demand with a gun, and they demand an amount also. So there is no difference between a normal beggar and these beggars. It's because a little royal, they have a lot of weapons, pamphlets, and they beg from us. So that is the only difference. And they do not care for others' lives. And the typical example which has been given is a bull. If you take by the nose ring. The nose is very sensitive for a bull. A bull is a very strong animal, okay? But if you pull the nose ring of the bull to the left side, even a small child, if she pulls, the bull moves towards the left. And when you move towards the right, the bull moves towards the right. But the bull thinks, I am the person who is deciding whether to go right or left. In the same way, the workers in the mode of ignorance think that they are controlling the entire universe. I am very powerful. That is their thought. But actually what happens, they are not even able to come out in the daytime. They are in constant fear that they will be caught sometime and will be punished. They have a lot of rivals. They may be killed. But even in that misery, they feel that satisfaction. Okay, I am the controller. I am the proprietor. That is working in the mode of ignorance. And working in a mode of passion. Working in a mode of passion, many examples we can give. These people are very greedy. They have their own kind of work and desire. And for that desire, they will start working. Say, for example, car racing, modeling, and then acting profession, and then politicians, they all come under this worker in the mode of passion. Why? Because, see, for example, my daughter, no, she likes to go in that giant wheel. When I went to this global village, there was a machine, I do not know the name of the machine, wherein it will take you to the top height, and from there you will be hanging down, upside down. Ulta, only with a belt on top, you will be hanging down. See, I was thinking that's a sort of a punishment. But these people, for them, it is a passion. They would like to go to great heights and torture themselves. It's torture, right? If you're hanging upside down. But they seek pleasure in it. Even Prabhuji also gave a very good example. If you eat something hot, they feel that it is pleasurable. So these people, they torture themselves. This actress or this modeling people, they torture themselves. For what? For name, fame, and money. And for honor. For this, they will do anything. They are ready to go to any level just to fulfill their dreams. These people are called the workers in the mode of passion. And then comes the worker in the mode of goodness. The worker in the mode of goodness just does his duty without expecting any results. He is not caring about success or failure. Both riches and happiness, he takes it in the same way. How can we understand this? Suppose in an office, there is a peon. He is the lowest level cadre worker in that office. He doesn't expect any honor from anyone. He treats both distress and happiness equally in the office. And he expects only a meager amount as wages for his services. He does mainly all the service, physical services, everything is done by him. But he accepts very meager amount as his salary. And with that, he maintains his body without expecting anything else. And he is not cared whether the business is making profit, whether the business is making loss. If he loses the job, he will jump to another company, isn't it? And he will find a job there. So this is a worker in the mode of goodness. How we can connect it? In the same way, what we should do, we should understand that we are in the lower level. We are servants of Krishna. Like how the knowledge you see everybody as the same spirit soul. How do we see everyone as same? Because just like how I am the servant of Krishna, the other person is also the servant of Krishna. We are all working for the pleasure of Krishna. I am not bothered how much of profit I will make. Because I am not the controller. Krishna is the controller. Krishna is the proprietor. Why should I worry about the business now? My work is to serve Krishna. And whatever Krishna offers me, I will take for my bodily maintenance. And if I meet with any calamities, I do not worry. I will just continue my service. I will not blame Krishna. I will just start looking for other opportunities, other devotional services. Whatever is coming in my path, I will take up and I will do my duty. This is a worker in the mode of goodness. And each and every one of us is striving to be in the mode of goodness. Hare Krishna. So can you go for the next slide, Vimalini Mataji?
So next is understanding in three modes. In Bhagavad Gita 18.30, a mode of goodness explaining performing action in terms of the direction of the scriptures based on what is to be done and what is not to be done. It's pravarti and nivarti. And one who knows that what to be done and what ought not to be done, what is not to be feared and what is to be feared, what is binding and what is liberating. This performing action in terms of scriptural direction is called pravarti. Not doing such action leads to entanglement. Next is understanding in passion. In 18.31 explains, a understanding which cannot distinguish between religion and irreligion, between action that should be done and action that should not be done, is in the mode of passion. Next is understanding ignorance. In Bhagavad Gita 18.32 explains, intelligence in the mode of ignorance is always working the opposite of the way it should. It accepts religion which are not actually religion and reject actual religion. That means consider irreligion to be religion and religion to be irreligion. Consider a great soul to be common man and a common man to be a great soul. Truth to be untruth and untruth to be truth. Under the spell of illusion and darkness, all activities, they simply take the wrong path. Therefore, their intelligence is in the mode of ignorance. Next, we are going to the practical application. Sorry, next, Supriyamri Mataji, you can take the determination in three modes.
Yeah. Now, determination in the three modes. What is determination? I have a desire. I want to achieve something. So, I work towards it. So I will go according to the mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. So in the mode of goodness, my determination will be like, I will give my own example. What I have thought is, I will quit drinking coffee and tea. And then I will follow the four regulative principles. I will chant 16 rounds and I will engage in the service of Vaishnavas and instructions of spiritual master. This was my goal or this was my tab list, okay, wish list. And I start working towards it. I may face failures. Many a times I have faced failures. I was not, for me, quitting coffee was a very big challenge because I was so much addicted from the childhood to drink coffee. So when I stopped, I got headache, I got anger issues and everything. But without deviating, I was just trying to follow with determination. Anything which is a goal which is not related to matter is in the mode of goodness. That means any goal which you fix, which is related to transcendence, is in the mode of goodness. And it is not changing. Throughout, even if I face failures, there is only one goal that I want to achieve. For that, I will be determined. So this is in the mode of goodness. Mode of passion. Mode of passion, the determination keeps changing. I will say my example. When I was a small child, I wanted to play with this card ball, cricket ball. Because we had a team, and every month, one person has to sponsor for that ball. So my papa was very strict. He never gives even 1 rupee free. He was very strict. So I couldn't get it from him. I tried crying. I tried all the other ways, but it did not work out. I was somehow determined because they said they will take me out of the team if I'm not bringing the ball. So what to do? I thought I will fast. So that was the easiest way. I said, no, I will not eat now. I will not drink now until you buy me a ball. I was determined for that. Card ball. And I sat outside near the door of the house. And I said, now I will not do. Initially, they ignored me. And towards afternoon, I was thinking myself, no, will they come and give me food or not? Because I started getting hungry and thirsty and all my friends were playing there. So I was thinking, will I be ignored like this? And I was getting so nervous. and I was impatient. Then after a long time, my mother came. Towards evening, my mother came and she pacified me and she gave a compromise. Okay, we cannot get you a card ball because it is very dangerous to play. I will give you some money. Go and buy some tennis ball or rubber ball and adjust with this one. Next month, we will see. Then I said, okay, something I'm getting. Instead of a card ball, I'm getting this. Okay, fine, I will take it. So I was very happy and I left my determination. And then again next month, there was another goal, new dress for Diwali. I wanted a dress which my neighbor was also wearing, the same type I wanted. So again, the fasting continued. This is in the mode of passion, meaning to say the politicians, they will take up fasting for a particular purpose. Okay. And then if there is another issue simultaneously going on, which is very big, they will compromise on this and they will go on to the other person. So according to our desire, the determination also changes and it is short-lived. My determination is short-lived. I easily compromise with whatever I get. So this is only for my bodily satisfaction. I engage my mind, life and senses for achieving that which gives me bodily pleasures. It has nothing to do with transcendence and there is no one specific goal. I will keep on changing. If failure, okay, no problem. I will change my desire and I will go for another one. Then mode of ignorance. Mode of ignorance determination is very easy. Everyone, everybody has practically spoken about that. An intoxicant person, when going to bed and getting up early in the morning, he experiences, I do not have any practical experience. I have heard this. So he gets a very bad headache and he is in misery. Immediately he will think, no, I should stop drinking. I will not drink now. So he brushes his teeth, has his morning breakfast, and immediately at 10 o'clock, the liquor shop is open. He will be the first person to go and stand there. Neither he is determined to do anything, nor he understands that it is giving him misery. This is in the mode of ignorance. Even for a few hours, his determination will not work. And the other side is, other phase of ignorance is, he will be determined that for freedom, they are fighting for freedom from the state. Every state want to become an independent country. Every district want to become a state. So there are a lot of unrelated fights going on in the name of religion, faith. We are divided in every way: language, religion, faith, nationality, and economically. Everywhere we are divided. So they all start fighting for their own reason without any purpose. There is no purpose. If you are going and asking them for what are you fasting, they do not say, because there are so many reasons, they can't say one reason. So this is, they just wanted to become famous. They just wanted to do some activity. For that they do. This is in the mode of ignorance. They are constantly in sleepy mode. They are lazy. They will sit in one place. If food is provided by somebody, they are very happy to have it. That is their determination. Their determination is not to work. That is their determination. Other than that, there is no other determination in their life. So, Vimalini Mataji, next slide. So now it is happiness. So if we want to achieve happiness, even in goodness state, Prabhuji has already explained, even in goodness state, we experience some sort of a misery. So how do we come out of this misery? Earlier we saw analysis of knowledge, action, understanding and determination. So all these four has to be aligned for transcendence. If your knowledge is for Krishna, action is for Krishna, your understanding and determination is for Krishna, then you will achieve happiness based on some devotee's guidance. That is, you need to have an association with a great soul. Then you will transcend this goodness using it as a skateboard. You will jump over, take a somersault and dive into the ocean of bhakti. In that way, you will relieve miseries. Otherwise, if you're staying in the mode of goodness, what happens? Initially, it is like a poison because you have to follow the four regulative principles. And I gave my own personal example, right? Leaving coffee, leaving tea, and for some people, leaving meat also, and leaving association of the worldly people. All this initially, it was very difficult because we get advices from many people. Do not leave the worship of Kuladevata. Your family will be in trouble. As if Kuladevata doesn't have any other work other than to see with the binocular or lens only my family, whether I'm offering her flowers or not. So it is like people are all around us are there for bewildering us. But if we are determined, then our happiness is in our hands. It is not with anybody else. And in the association of great souls, we will be transcending this happiness and experience bliss. So this is happiness in the mode of goodness and how to come out of it. So I happiness in the mode of passion, Prabhupada has given a very good analogy. Example, I need not say anything else. I will use the same example. A young man and a woman, when they are meeting, during the teenage or newlywed, if you see, they are so happy together. They can't live without each other. If the wife gives one missed call, the husband gives 10 times calls. And if she's not picking up, he gets panicked and he may start from the office also, thinking that she's in trouble. So this is the scenario of the initial stages of the marriage. And anything and everything that she asks for will be satisfied, or he asks for will be satisfied. This is because they are experiencing some bodily pleasures and that gives them the happiness. But later on, what happens is it decides whether we are in the mode of goodness or passion. If the husband and wife maintains the same love for 40 or 50 years, and if they are devoting their entire family for a transcendental cause, then that marriage is in the mode of goodness. And the entire family can be transcended using it as a diving board. But otherwise, either the person will live in hell, or they will divorce. Because 20 missed calls also, he will not bother. Whatever she says in the morning to buy some vegetable, he will forget. I'm speaking because I'm a lady, I'm speaking about the men. So men will be knowing more about what we are doing. So this is the mode of passion. So they cannot adjust with each other. Either they will divorce, or they will separate, or they will live in hell for the sake of the children. This is the mode of passion. And the mode of ignorance, he neither wants commitment. He neither wants have children, but he wants only enjoyment. It is like that itch, you know, itch. As long as and when the itch comes, when we itch, it gives us some sort of a pleasure. So they seek for happiness outside the wedding lock and outside the, they approach the sex workers practically, and they get happiness out of it. But how it is in the mode of ignorance? Because their entire wealth is being robbed. Their entire human life is going waste. On top of it, they are getting diseases also. And even then, they go out for that. This is the mode of ignorance. They speak very harsh words. They are not at all polite. They don't correlate. They are continuously intoxicated. And Prabhuji also gave a very good example of a person who is lying in a garbage or in a drainage. And the hogs are licking him. He thinks he is lying in a palace, and he has a lot of pet animals who are coming and licking him and waking him up. He thinks he is a king. So that is in the mode of ignorance. Means wherever he is, he thinks, he assumes himself to be happy. Just like how the camel, when it eats the thorns, it mixes along with the blood and it experiences some happiness. The same is in the mode of ignorance. Like that, the person who is suffering will experience happiness. This is the mode of happiness. Ignorance. Hare Krishna, can you change? Yeah, now for the practical application. We have already seen passion and goodness. I will just explain. Passion is, I'm talking about myself. When I was newlywed, I wanted to have, we did not have a house. So we were staying in a rented house. So I went and approached my Prabhu and I said, we need a house badly because I want to have my own house. He said, no, I will not invest in that because maintenance cost, other cost and all will be very too high. We will go a rented house. However you like, we will see a house and we will stay. No, I said, no, I want a house means I want a house. And we started working. Both of us were working for 3 years and we got a house, 2-bedroom flat. Then I decided, no. I'm not satisfied because now we have 2 more children. I need a 4-bedroom house, at least minimum, for them to stay. How can I be satisfied with that? And on top of it, I want to send them to good college, good school. I want to save for their future. In that way, because I was in the mode of passion, I was never satisfied. I used to continuously say, see for some other job, your salary is not enough. See for some other job, your salary is not enough. And to children also, I say, get more marks, come first in everything. These are all in the mode of passion. We will never be satisfied. Our dreams go higher and higher. And we rely on demigods. That has already been spoken by many presenters here. Even Lavakumar Prabhuji also spoke about it, how he worshipped demigods. I'm sorry, I'm taking a lot of time because it had 5 topics to speak about. That is why a lot of verses. I'm sorry, I'll conclude it now. So with that, demigods worship goes on. And I started asking for that. And in the mode of goodness, I have only spiritual goal, definite goal. I'm happy in all the circumstances. I understand that everything is the mercy of Krishna. And I go in for association with the devotees. And I'm very happy now. So I will give over to Vimalini Mataji for conclusion. Hari Bol.
Thank you, Mataji. I am speaking about mode of ignorance. Before telling the practical application in my life, I would like to thank all my Shiksha Gurus for holding our hands and leading us through the path of Krishna consciousness. I was eating non-vegetarian before coming to Krishna consciousness. I was not aware of scriptural injections. And though I used to worship demigods, I never knew that there were four regulatory principles. But I was in ignorance, thinking that the meat eating gives us strength, and egg gives protein, and chicken, if we are eating chicken, it cures our fever, cold, lose some like that. This was my general idea. When I attended my Bhakti Usha classes, slowly I realized the truth of what I had been doing. Very quickly, I refined my ways and stopped meat eating within a year. Then I could see a lot of changes in my behavior because earlier I was getting frequent anger issues, even with my own daughter, husband, relatives, friends. I am very short-tempered person. So everything is under ignorance. Now, then, and also I lavishly eat food from outside. If I'm hearing any special food or special name, and I am telling to my husband to go to that restaurant and buy that food like that. And also I am very lazy and every time sleeping and getting late in the morning. So these are my ignorance. But now, after joining in the Krishna consciousness, that Bhakti Shastri Viksha class, then I realized the importance of the following four principles, the regulative principles. After taking the Bhakti Yoga, my family life has become more peaceful. And because of that, our spiritual master's guidance only, we came from that all. Now I was able to overcome my ignorance in certain level. So thank you for everything to hold our to the Krishna consciousness. So I'm thanking to all my spiritual masters. Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And I sincerely apologize for the delay in not keeping the time limit, because the verses were more and I had to explain with example on personal application also. That's why I'm very sorry, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna, please forgive me.
We'd like to thank this group also by three times chanting. Hare Bol, Hare Bol. We'll come to now our 17th chapter. Suppose start from the 20th verse, 17.20.
Yes, Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu. 20th verse, Prabhu. 20th
verse. So 20, 21, 22, they talk about charity in three modes. Dātavyam iti yatdānam diyate anupakārine deshe kāle cha patre cha taddānam sattvikam smritam. Please read.
Charity given without the expectation of return, the proper time and place, and also to a worthy person, is considered to be in the mode of goodness.
When one doesn't expect any return, very clear. And proper time and place. And to a worthy person also. So this, already some devotee spoke about how it has been a part of Vedic culture where the customarily some charities were given by considering all these things. I still remember that whenever there would be change of seasons, so during that time, there would be times when we are supposed to give charity. For example, when the winters are supposed to arrive, so that is a good time for giving charity. So then we would be told by our parents that we go to different temples there, and priests and the beggars who are sitting outside, who always stay there outside temple only. So then we would give them quilt, because winter is going to approach now. So there is a consideration of time and place. Place means the place, people who stay there, because they do bhajan and they keep on sitting there expecting charity. So they are proper people. At the same time, because winters are approaching, then one is supposed to give quilt. And when summers would approach, we would give them a muskmelon, a pot for cooling the water, fan, hand fan, and then we would give them khichdi, some salt, ghee. So in this way, this was appropriate thing. So this has been an Indian custom where things are given according to time, place, circumstances. Then such a charity is called, said to be charity in a mode of goodness. So it should be given to worthy person who won't misuse it. And it has to be done according to time and place. So this is charity in mode of goodness. And certainly charity for Krishna consciousness, spreading Krishna consciousness is divine. So such a charity, it helps a person to get rid of the attachment to money. So that is why charity is extremely essential for the grihasthas. So it's recommended that the grihasthas should always keep some prasadam with them. Because when we go out, we may not find people who are worthy of accepting charity. But prasad is something which nobody misuses. So you give them prasad, you tell them to chant Hare Krishna. So that will be beneficial for them. So that is how it is supposed to be a culture, that whenever grihasthas travel, they keep some prasadam with them. So that anybody asks for charity, we can give them prasadam. There is charity in mode of goodness. And then charity in mode of passion. Yattu pratyu karartham phalam uddishya va punaha diyate cha parisklishtam tad danam rajasam smritam. Please read.
But charity performed with the expectation of some return, or which a desire for fruitive results, or in a grudging mood, is said to be charity in the mode of passion. Hare Krishna.
So expectation of some return means people expect that we'll get some respect, some recognition from somewhere. So that is charity in mode of passion. Or they have some fruitive desire. So generally, many times people give charity because of karmakanda principles. So they are expecting some piety to come upon them. Like in Calcutta, Calcutta is ruled by Marwadis, basically, if you say, really. So all these Marwadi people know one thing, that if we don't give charity, we will not be able to hold our money. So they train their children to give charity from their childhood. But then they are very specific about doing it for the purpose of getting piety so that money comes. So I am staying in Gosala. Many devotees, many these Marwadi, they come to Gosala. But then they have some specific item that only they will give to the cow. Why? Because in particular, this particular season, if you give this particular thing to the cow, let us say green grass, then your ancestor will get benefit. But we tell them already there are a lot of green grass because we are in Gosala and our farms are there nearby. So can you give something else for the cows? So then they will not speak anything. They don't want to offend sadhu, but they won't give also. Because that is, you won't get any piety out of it. So then that is expectation of some return. So this is in mode of passion. I'll take one more verse and then I'll take the questions. And the certain mode of ignorance. Adesha kale yaddanam अपात्रेभ्यश्च दीयते असत् कृतम् अविज्ञातम् तत्तामसम् उदाहृतम्. Please read.
And charity performed at an impure place, at an impure time, to unworthy persons, or without proper attention and respect, is said to be in the mode of ignorance.
So impure place means, for example, there are some beggar sitting in front of a liquor shop. If you give him charity, what will suddenly he do? You understand. So after he gets all the charity, he'll go to the liquor shop and buy the liquor. So then it's impure place. Improper time. The same thing I spoke, that if you don't consider time, no, in the summer season is approaching, you're giving a quilt to a person. It doesn't make any sense. He's not going to use it in the summer time. The time consideration should be there properly, improper time. To unworthy person. Already we know a certain person is a drunkard. If we give him charity, he'll drink more. So then it's a improper time. An unworthy person. And without proper attention and respect. The person gives charity just to show that he is so great. So then person just gives like, you know, oh, take it. So then he gives out of pride. So then such a charity, that is all considered to be charity in mode of ignorance. So now we can do two questions. Gopi Priya Mataji has a question.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Prabhuji, you mentioned about the charity in the mode of goodness, that we should keep some prasadam ready and whenever beggars approach, we can give them prasadam. But in my own personal experience, I have seen that sometimes people don't want prasadam. Even if we give them, they just throw it away because they want only money. So in that case, do we incur any karma for disrespecting prasadam?
No, we should give them prasadam. We should tell them you take here only prasadam. Not that you carry with you. So giving prasadam means they should eat there. For example, Mayapur, Prabhupada is very strict. That in Mayapur, if you are giving a prasadam, don't give prasadam in their dabbas. Bengalis have a habit of carrying dabbas with them. So then what they do is, they take prasadam in the home and then they mix it with the fish and then they eat. So that's an offense. So I did a lot of serving in the Gaza kitchen and many other places. So they're very strict. Earlier I couldn't understand why they're so strict. But after staying in Bengal for so many years, now I understand. So they have a habit of carrying. They'll eat and they'll give 2, 3, 4 dabbas. No, carrying all the prasad. So then we should not give. So that we have to be careful about. And also, if let us say a person is saying, no, I'll not take prasad, just give me some money. Then you just give them a holy name, that's all. That's a transcendental charity. Because what do you mean by, you know, I'll not take prasad? Then we don't have some other good intentions. You want something else.
Okay, Prabhu. Thank you.
Ravi Prabhu has a question. And raised.
No, I have raised, Prabhu. Oh, okay. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna? Yes. Are you able to hear me, Prabhuji?
Yes, we can, Prabhuji. Yes, we can.
But Prabhuji is not.
Prabhuji is not able to hear it.
Some internet problem was there.
Yes, Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes, bro.
Prabhuji, when we are explaining, when you're explaining this 20th verse, you mentioned that charity in preaching Krishna consciousness is divine. Mm. Okay. Does it come under goodness or pure goodness? And my second question is, the prasadam also you mentioned that it is in the mode of goodness. Is it prasadam also is in the mode of goodness or in pure goodness, Prabhuji?
It's pure goodness.
Okay.
So both giving...
Both are pure goodness.
Both are transcendental. So they are not goodness. So what I spoke before, that when you given temple means, we given ordinary temple where beggars are sitting outside, according to the Vedic scriptures, then it is in goodness.
No, when you were mentioning about prasadam, you said prasadam, we should give it prasadam to people. As you gave the example, we should keep prasadam. That's why
that I Hari, so what to do? Very lot of problems with the internet. So what I'll do? Okay. Some of the devotees hand raised. Tanuja Mataji, you have a question?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, pranams. Prabhuji, my question is, what about blood donation, eye donation, which group does that fall into?
Charity. So blood donation and eye donation, all these things, again, we have to see the whole criteria. It is done selflessly, etc. For the purpose of, let us say, devotee is there. So then, fine, it may come to be transcendental charity. Because you are helping that person to progress in spiritual life, which is a devotee. Otherwise, it's not generally recommended. So let us say, like now when Shyam Sundar Poo, he needed a liver, doing the liver transplant. Then many devotees came forward to help. So then he had done so much service for Prabhupada, establishing the movement worldwide. Then giving that time a charity from some body part, it's considered very transcendental. But otherwise, we should not do.
Thank you.
Otherwise, whatever that person does, we'll get the karma for that. Let us see, turns into a terrorist. Then, no. Lot of connectivity problem is there. Okay, Rakesh Prabhu, you can ask question now. What will you?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandatana. Prabhuji, in text 4, in translation it is said, men in the mode of goodness worship the demigods. Those in the mode of passion worship demons. and those in the mode of ignorance worship ghosts and spirits. Prabhuji, I have one small doubt. Men in the mode of goodness worship the demigods. But if somebody worshipping demigods is for only material benefit, then how it comes in the mode of goodness?
According to Varnasram Dharma, there are certain systems of respecting and worshipping the demigods. So then person may do it dutifully without expecting any return. That basically becomes a Niskam Karma Yoga. For example, people in Vedic circles, this I saw in my childhood. So because before coming to Krishna consciousness, so my mother, in our home, we never cooked onion and garlic. But then in the afternoon time, what mother would do is, she would offer a portion of first food, she would offer to the demigods. So they put in the fire and they do some sort of home. This happens in many, many pious homes of India. So that is without expecting and offer any result. And then we would offer that particular chapati along with the bhoga to the cow, because cow is the embodiment of all the demigods. That all the demigods will get pleased. So that's a part of Vedic culture. So in that case, many times people don't expect a result. They do it as a duty. Okay?
Okay, Ramesh.
Okay. Kathir Vilpu.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. I can hear you.
Yes, I have one doubt. It is the person who died, his organs taking out and giving to somebody else.
Okay.
Somebody else with organs, the person is.
Your voice is very low, bro. You may have to speak maybe in the mic. Your voice is very.
Can you hear me?
Yes, bro. Now it is better. Yeah.
Yeah, it is the person who wants to die, his organ is taken out and giving somebody else. It is exalted. Yes. So that person doing some illegal activity.
Hari, hari, it's still not clear to.
Okay, I will try to.
If you speak very slowly and very loudly, then I may be able to hear you.
Okay, I will try to. Hari Bol, Prabhu, I will catch you.
You will?
Prabhu, he is saying he will type in chat box.
Okay. So I saw.
Adir, chat box la type pani anupunga.
Okay. He'll type in chat box. Fine. Till Molly Joseph Prabhu can ask this question.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam. Prabhuji, it is said that we should serve Gomata personally, but if we are not getting a chance or it's not feasible, we are donating online to a Gaushala. And in that case, in which mode it will be, and what will be the, is it good to donate in a Gaushala for cow fodder or construction of the Gaushala building?
If you do it with a understanding that cows are very dear to Krishna, and we do that, it is transcendental. It doesn't remain material at all.
Okay. Even it is beyond mode of goodness.
Yes, it's beyond mode of goodness. If you can see that connection with Krishna, it's in mode of beyond mode of goodness also.
Okay.
Haribu.
Haribu.
Ravi Tejapu.
Hare Krishna, Dandavat Pranam.
Yes.
The charity given to a Brahmana again is being given to others. There is one reference in Bhagavatam also. Can you please explain that elaborately?
Okay. So you are saying as it is given to others?
Yeah. Means it's charity, one item charity given to Brahmana. The same item again been, means I have given one to Brahmana, And somehow, again, I repeatedly given that to Samadhar also. It happens. There is one reference in Bhagavatam, the story.
Okay. So there are different references in Bhagavatam. I don't remember which reference you are referring to.
That one Kshatriya king donates cow to the Brahmana, and again that cow return and again come to the Kshatriya.
Okay.
That that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, some story was recently I heard.
Just King Nirga. King Nirga.
Okay.
So King Nirga story, that is a Prabhu different thing. King Nirga story was spoken to make us understand that how even if somebody is extremely pious, despite that there is a chance of being reborn again. Is one lesson which comes from there. Because what happens is this cow comes back and then he gives this charity to someone else. So because of that, what happens is both the Brahmanas become angry with him and he's cursed to become they didn't even curse him. But because Brahmanas were dissatisfied, he had to become a lizard. But fortunately, he became a lizard in the Dwarka. So then he was saved by Krishna's grace. So there, the danger of just being pious is spoken there. And also the second lesson is that you should not offend the Brahmana. So these were the two lessons because of which this particular story is spoken. But in general, when we give a charity to the Brahmana, it is considered to be in mode of goodness.
Okay.
Tilak Prabhu?
Prabhu, I just had one question regarding Maharaj Nriga. In that pastime, we see that that once he commits the sins, then the Yamadutas become very excited to catch him. So I was wondering, if one is like a devotee but is not going back to Godhead after their birth, do they still enter into Yamaraja's court, or do they?
No.
Or is pardon?
No.
Oh, so only if you have some sinful activity, you go to Yamaraja's court.
Yes.
Okay.
So there is a whole verse given by Yamaraj himself in 6th canto. So he speaks a beautiful verse. Jivana vakti bhagavat guna naam deham chetasthana smrti tacharanar vindam krishnaya no namati yachir ekadapi tam anadham asatu akrit vishnu krityan. So this verse is, those whose tongue don't chant the holy names, Jivana Vakti Bhagavata Guna Naam Deham Chetas Chana Smarti Tacharanar Vindam. Those whose minds don't remember the lotus feet of the Lord. Krishnayano Namati Yachare Kedabi. Those whose heads don't bow down to the lotus feet of Krishna. Tan Anadham Asato Akrit Vishnu Krishnan. So he tells to Yamdutas, you bring such people to me. So except devotees, practically everybody is subjected to Yamraj, but not devotees.
So even pious non-devotees also go to Yamaraj's court?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much, Prabhu.
Kalpana Mataji?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, my Prabhu had asked a question. He was traveling, so the voice was not audible properly. He was just asking that regarding the donation only, once a person has expired, people donate organs after the death. So such organs, if it is used, if it is donated for a person or it is utilized for a person who is involved in illegal activities, after death also that this thing karma will be transferred to that person.
Yes.
Okay, that was a question. So that also will be
actually possible. Generally, many times what happens is people donate their whole body also. Then it becomes extremely dangerous because you have attachment for the body, and your body is being experimented by the college students for medical purposes.
Yes.
So many people do that. But then what happens is then soul being attached to the body has to hover around like a ghost.
So okay.
That's why in a Vedic culture, we recommend that their body should be burnt. Because if bodies are not burnt, then the soul hovers. Only for those people who are extremely transcendental, like our sannyasis.
Mm.
So for them, we make samadhi. Because they are not attached to the body and they are going to go back to Godhead. Otherwise, for anyone who is like, you know, has little attachment to body, has to hover around. So that's why some sannyasis were even very careful also. Like Bhakti Jita Maharaj very clearly told, you should burn my body and then you should bury. Then you can take the ashes and make a samadhi. So he didn't want to take any risk. So in general, it's very risky.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, one more devotee had asked a question. Sometimes we are forced to pay charity to government when we avail service from government. Means taken an amount along with service fee. We don't know what purpose they are using this money. See, this is not even charity also. In one sense, it's like, no, it is as good as a tax. Okay, Ramesh Nartu. It is as good as a tax. So you can't do anything about it. Similarly, I was telling that anything which is required for execution of Krishna consciousness, even if it, let us say, seems to be forced, we don't incur sin for that. Some gunda forces us to give charity. And if we don't give him charity, he'll kill us or he'll beat us. Then, if he breaks our hand, we can't pick up the beadwork and chant Hare Krishna. So then we give him charity. So that is anukula sankalpa pratikula vivarjana. Whatever is favorable for Krishna consciousness, we do. Unless until you are a Kshatriya and you can really punish.
Okay.
Then that's a different thing. Kshatriya means you are a policeman and you can take action, that's a different thing. Otherwise, we have to be intelligent.
Okay. But in the test, you know, in the bill, there is mentioning some charity name and all, but we don't know what charity it is. And
that's namesake charity only.
Hmm.
Charity means something which is voluntarily given.
Uh-huh.
If there is no voluntary expect, there is no free will, then it is a namesake charity.
Okay.
Lot of questions are coming. So these are the last questions I won't take after that. Huh? Otherwise, it will be charity class. Okay. Sakhi Madhuri Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Yes, ma'am.
Prabhuji, we understand that we have but sometimes we find that some ladies they are carrying a child and they are begging in that traffic signal and all. So we cannot give charity to them based on sympathy and all. No, it comes under ignorance. But not only that, even it was my personal experience, Prabhuji, when I went to this Kedarnath, no, during that time. Aguri, he asked charity from me, Prabhuji. But my Prabhu has given him some money. I was walking behind my Prabhu. He again asked some money from me. I did not give that money, Prabhu. At that time, he abused and he cursed me, saying that you are going to die because of some great disease. It's not going to cure. So my question is, suppose if we have the understanding that whom we should donate and whom we should not donate, but still, we find that people are cursing and abusing. So my question is, are we going to get some kind of a result from that type of curse, Prabhu?
Okay, see, sometimes there is a saying, and I'll clarify certain things. If we are sure that that person is really in need and he is not going to misuse money, now he may not even use for transcendental purpose. He may need for do it for some curing or some disease or something like that. We can tell them to inspire them to chant Hare Krishna. You tell them, I'll give you money, you chant Hare Krishna. And then we give him money, then there's such a charity is also not considered very bad. That is okay. But we should be sure his person is not misusing. That's the main thing. And second thing is, if somebody is cursing, then it doesn't mean that the curse would come. There is a saying in Sanskrit, Sakuni Sape Guru Maranjaya, that the vulture curses the cow, then let the cow die. Why? If the cow dies, I'll eat it. That doesn't mean the curse of the vulture is going to work. So similarly, if somebody curses like that, he may be doing because he's very, certain person is very much addicted to liquor and he desperately needs money. But that doesn't mean we give him charity. So then such a curse won't work. Okay. But if we really see that genuinely that person is not going to misuse, and then there's no flaw in giving charity. you can be charitable, dispose and tell them that okay, okay, I'm going to charity, make sure you chant Hare Krishna one round every day. Okay?
Prabhuji, what about the Tagore's, Prabhuji? Huh? Devoted to Lord Shiva, no? The Tagore's who are there in Kedarnath, but that their curse, Prabhu, because there are they're actually worshipping Lord Shiva, no?
Are you giving them prasad? If they are really Aghoris, means really they are worshipper of Shiva, they will not say no. But you don't have to give them money. And actually, those who are real Aghori, they don't beg. Anybody who is begging, if Naga Babas come to know, they'll kill him. But Nagas have a pride, they don't beg. They are known for austerity. They can fast for days together. So some beggars in the, they dress as Aghoris and then they beg. That's a different thing. Okay?
Okay, Prabhu. Thank you, Prabhu.
The last three questions are there. Raghunandan, too.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Janvatpana. I have two questions, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, at the modern days, we are in the scope of a government office or something like that, to work, to get done some work, either it is spiritual or either it is in material or life. Something the officers or some the government officers may somebody who don't come and do some work. So something nowadays is everybody expecting some money so that the work will be done. So in this situation, what to do, Prabhuji? In the conditions, in the material activities in our life, and also spiritually, when you go do something spiritual, like even temple construction, I also maybe there also they expect some money. So in this case, what you should do. And the second thing is, for example, when you go for tour, something like that, taking some devotees and staying somewhere, and wherever we are going there, we have to get a good facility or something like that. We are giving some tips during this trip. This also is recommendable or not good? What should consider? Which charges comes from this? The tips maybe in the hotel or somebody, you know, to get some darshan of the Lord. Also, this comes. We are giving some paying money, additional money, and get the entrance into the temple. So like this, all this comes under which category, Prabhuji?
So you asked practically so many types of charity.
Yes,
not a small amount. So it depends on time, place, circumstances. So for example, for temple construction, we may have to give money to the government officers. That's a service. Because otherwise things won't be done. So even what to say of giving charity, we have to do many things. Sometimes temple have to be constructed. There are some gundas who are harassing you. You may have to harass your own gundas and no, take care of them. So in that way, we have to be practical. If it is especially our service of Krishna. But when it is for our own sense gratification, we have to see that really it should be something which is just needed for our Krishna consciousness. If that thing is getting curtailed in some way, then we may do all these things, but otherwise we should not do. So that totally depends on case. The best thing is at that time is that we consult some of our Siksha Guru and we ask him then what should we do. Because certain things are suddenly accepted facts. Like especially in India, the system is so corrupt that everybody knows now that here unless until you give a bribe, things won't work. So then in such a condition, things may be okay. But if you are doing it like for getting something extra for sense gratification, then we may avoid it. So these things are totally dependent on time, place, circumstances. So they need a detailed guidance. And same thing may be different for different people. Let us say you bribe a TT for getting a seat. Now totally depends on time, place, circumstances. If your wife is pregnant, she needs to take rest, then bribing a TT may not be bad. Or if you are having a very big distance journey, and after going there, we have some preaching program. So then that may create an obstacle for our practice of Krishna consciousness or for preaching program. But if let us say it is a little bit distance only, no, 1 hour of distance. So then it may not be required. So these are totally depend on time plus circumstances. For devotee, one very clear way of demarking things is anukula sankalpa pratikula vivarjana. Whatever is favorable for Krishna consciousness, we do it. Whatever unfavorable, we avoid it. And after having this consciousness, if we do certain things, and then we do something wrong also, let us say, without having any improper intention, then Krishna takes care of that. At least our intention has to be very clear. Okay? So, okay. Giving tips, etc. also, tips, if tips are required for helping devotees to be taken care, then we may give it. But otherwise, we should not give. Because generally, people misuse it. Because in Vedic culture, generally, sudras won't be given much money. They would be given a lot of facilities. Actually, I remember in my grandfather's house, it was like a big family, he had 10 children. Grandfather. So then practically it was like a ISKCON temple only. 50-60 people would stay. Very big two houses were there. So then they had their own tailor, own person for washing clothes, ironing clothes, and a lot of servants were there. But then they would take care of the servants. So they won't give them much money, but they would give them a lot of facilities, like daughter's marriage is there. So that time they held the daughter to get married. Similarly, person is deceased. They give charity for taking care of their diseases. So in this way, because if you give them money, then they may misuse it. They don't know how to handle money. So that taken care without allowing them to misuse the facility. So that is the general culture. So basic thing is time, place, circumstances. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So now last two questions. Kalpana Madhavi, already you asked question, na?
Yes, Prabhuji, one more question. I just have a clarification actually. People who are very rich, Prabhuji, they are not concerned about, they give a selfless charity like building an orphanage or building some old age homes or some hospitals which basically runs on trust. No expectation of anything in return. Purely on a selfless attitude. Does it come under any other, or it comes under modes of goodness, Prabhuji?
It will come in mode of goodness.
Still it is in the mode of goodness.
It will be in mode of goodness. Hmm. But if let us say, if they do it according to scriptures, then they will be elevated further in goodness. If it is not according to scriptures, then they may continue in goodness only.
Okay.
Ravi Teja Guru, last question.
Hare Krishna, Dandavat Pranam. Actually, my question was answered. I wanted to ask intention, because the elder people, before dying, they tell our body parts should be donated. So after their death, their intention is good. But after their death, it goes to the donation banks, and to whom it has been supplied, we don't know. So in this condition, intention, you have told, already answered. Intention is the most important thing.
True, pro, but still I would say when it comes to donating body parts, generally let us be a little careful about it, because it's a very important injunction to burn the body. Because if the attachment remains, then person has to maybe hover around. So for, okay, fine, somebody is doing it for devotees, that's easy to understand. But then it is a bit dangerous if it is done for just like that. Okay. So now we'll just cover the rest of the verses. At least we covered chapter number 17. Om Tat Sat Iti Nirdeso Brahmanastri Vidasmitaha Brahmanastena Vidasya Vedasya Yagyasya Vihita Pura. Please read.
From the beginning of creation, the three words Om Tat Sat were used to indicate the Supreme Absolute Truth. These three symbolic representations were used by Brahmanas while chanting the hymns of the Vedas and during sacrifices for the satisfaction of the Supreme.
Yeah. Om is basically, okay, now Krishna will explain also. So Brahmanas would use Om Tat Sat or Hari Om Tat Sat. You will find that in many organizations, they use it. Om Tat Sat or Hari Om Tat Sat. So I went to learn yoga in one institute. So after teaching yoga also they use Om Tat Sat, Hari Om Tat Sat. Because Om is referring to Lord Vishnu. If you remember, already we talked about Om. And how Omkar is an expansion of Hare Krishna Mahamantra only. And nobody objects Omkar. So I'll explain the significance totally at the end of the verses. Now 24 talks about Om. Tasmat Om iti udahritya jnana dana tapa kriya pravattante vidhanokta satatam brahmavadinam.
Therefore, transcendentalists undertaking performances of sacrifice, charity and penance in accordance with scriptural regulations begin always with Om to attain the Supreme.
So, because everything has to be done on behalf of the Supreme Lord, for the pleasure of the Supreme Lord. That's why any Vedic charity, penance, they all begin with Omkar. Even mantras begin with Omkar. So unless until tongue and ears are purified by the name of Lord Vishnu, they don't become eligible for any Vedic rites. So it has to be done for the pleasure of Lord Vishnu. Did I give example of Vrishbhanu Maharaj in the class? No?
No, Prabhuji.
Okay. So in one of the pastimes or of the appearance of Radharani, this particular thing comes in the Puranas. So in one of the appearances, in one of the kalpas, when Radharani appeared, so that time, wife of Vrishbhanu Maharaj, Kirtida. So she recommended him that we are not getting any child. So why don't you pray to Katyayani? If you worship Katyayani, you will certainly get a child. So then he starts worshiping Katyayani, meditating on Katyayani, but Katyayani doesn't appear. But while he was meditating on Katyayani, suddenly a particular message came in his heart that unless until ears and mouth are pure by chanting the names of Lord Hari, demigods cannot be pleased. So then he went to a nearby ashram of Kritumuni. Kritumuni would stay nearby. And then he asked from Kritumuni, and Kritumuni spoke lot of glories of the holy names of the Lord. So Kritumuni spoke that how unless until one purifies one's tongue by chanting the holy names of Hari, one purifies one's ears when the holy name enters in the ears, and one purifies one's heart of all the misgivings, when holy name enters the heart, demigods cannot be pleased. No Vedic ritual is going to work. Hari Bol, am I audible now?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay. Big problem with connectivity today. So then he said, in this way, when ears, tongue and heart are not purified, demigods cannot be pleased. So then he gave them this Hare Krishna Mahamantra, which we chant every day. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Iti Sotskam Nam Nam. Second line was different. It is not Kali Kalmasanam. It is some other line. Kali Kalmas Nasam, this line comes in Kali Santaran Upanishad. In this particular, the meaning of their second line is that in any age, this is the only solution. We say on Kali Yuga is the only solution, but this line says that in any age, whether it is Satyuga, Dwapara Yuga, Trita Yuga, Kali Yuga is the only solution. Nata Partare Paya Sarvadeshu Videshu Dirshate. After seeing all the Vedas, this seems to be the only solution. And then he starts chanting Hare Krishna, and by that Katyayani gets pleased. So then he was not worshipping Katyayani, and Katyayani gets pleased. And then Katyayani gives him a golden egg from which Radharani appeared. So that is how, unless until holy name touches the tongue, any Vedic mantra doesn't work. Any Gyan, Tapa, Dan doesn't work at all. So that's why this Omkar is extremely important in the Vedic mantras. So people who have hesitation to chant the name of Krishna or Ram directly, they can chant Omkar. Now we'll go to the next one. Tat Edi Anbisandhaya Phalam Jnana Tapa Kriya Dan Kriya Savivedha Kriyante Moksha Kangshibhi. Please read.
Without desiring fruitive result, one should perform various kind of sacrifice, penances, and charity with the word tat. The purpose of such transcendental activities is to get free from material entanglement. Hare Krishna.
So tat means it is referring to the spiritual abode of the Lord. That I am doing it for the sake of the Supreme Lord. I am doing it for the transcendental purpose, not for any material purpose. That is the meaning of Tat. So Om Tat means I am doing it for that Om, for the pleasure of Supreme Lord. So I am not doing it for any piety. I am not going to heavenly planets or getting any material benefit. That is the meaning of Om Tat. And now the word, meaning of Sad will come. That's 26-27. Sad bhave sadhu bhave cha sat iti etat prayujyate prasaste karmani tatha sat shabda parth yujyate
yurge
tapasi dane cha sthita saditi chochyate karma chayav sadirthiyam sadatye vabhidhiyate. Please read.
The absolute truth is the objective of devotional sacrifice, and it is indicated by the word Sat. The performer of such sacrifice is also called Sat. As are all works of sacrifice, penance, and charity which true to the absolute nature are performed to please the Supreme Person, O Son of Pratap. Yeah.
So Sat is basically referring to eternal things or spiritual thing. So Om Tat Sat. I am doing it for that pleasure of that Supreme Lord. And that particular thing is Sad Bhave or Sadhu Bhave. It is for a transcendental situation. So transcendental situation is referred to as Sat. You can read the purport also.
Hare Krishna. The words prasaste karmani or prescribed duties indicates that there are many activities prescribed in the Vedic literature which are purificatory process beginning from the time of conception up to the end of one's life. Such purificatory processes are adapted for the ultimate liberation of the living entity. In all such activities, it is recommended that one vibrate Om Tat Sat. The words Sadbhava and Sadbhava indicates the transcendental situation. Acting in Krishna consciousness is called Sattva, and one who is fully consciousness of the activities of Krishna consciousness is called Sadhu. In the Srimad Bhagavatam 3.25.25, it is said that the transcendental subject matter becomes clear in the association of the devotees. The words used are satam prasangat, prasangat, prasangat. Without good association, one cannot achieve transcendental knowledge. When initiating a person or offering the sacred thread, one vibrates the word Om Tat Sat. Similarly, in all kinds of performance of yajna, the object is supreme, Om Tat Sat. The representative, the word Tat Atyam further means offering services to anything which represents the supreme, including such service as cooking, helping in Lord's temple, or any other kind of work from broadcasting the glories of the Lord. The supreme word Om Tat Sat are thus used in many ways to perfect all activities and make everything complete. Hare Krishna.
Basically, this word Om Tat Sat is referring that it is meant for the pleasure of Guru and Gauranga. So after Mangal Arati, generally what we chant? All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to Guru and Gauranga. So it is something similar. The Om Tat Sat, that I am doing this thing for the pleasure of Supreme Lord and His devotees. So by that what happens is consciousness gets prepared that this is particular activity is not meant for my pleasure, it is meant for the pleasure of Supreme Lord. So any activity done for the pleasure of Krishna and his devotees, it becomes spiritual. So it has to be according to Vedas, and after doing it according to Vedic scriptures, when we do it for the pleasure of Supreme Lord, it becomes transcendental. Now suddenly, those which are not with the activities, we can't say it's transcendental. So our acharyas give the example. The government says that citizens can earn in any way they like. But that doesn't mean that citizens can earn by looting, murdering, or doing any such activities. So similarly, we can do any activity and offer it to the Supreme Lord, and it becomes pure devotion service when it does for the pleasure of the Lord. But certainly that has to be according to the scriptures. So anything done according to Varnasram with the intention to please Krishna and Vaishnavas, then it becomes devotion service. So that's the basic purpose of this verse. And now last one. Asraddaya hutam dattam tapas taptam kritam chayat asat iti uchate partha na cha tat preteno iha. Please read.
Anything done is sacrifice, charity or penance. Matri, you can go.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Anything done as sacrifice, charity or penance without faith in the Supreme, O son of Pritha, is impermanent. It is called asat and is useless both in this life and the next. Hare Krishna.
So although these so many activities are mentioned in goodness, passion, ignorance, but when it is not done for the with faith on the Supreme Lord, then it becomes asat. So even for it to remain a yoga, at least faith on the Supreme Lord has to be there. So that is the basic thing. So then it becomes impermanent. It is useless in this life also and in the next life also. So in this way, this particular chapter, it talks about how sattvic actions of various types are to be performed with faith in the Supreme Lord, and then they ultimately lead to one's elevation. So the basically summary of this whole chapter. Now I'll take questions. So Deepal Prabhu has a question.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Prabhuji, in the verse 23rd, Prabhupada has mentioned first goal, second goal, and third goal. Om is the first goal, Tat is the second goal, and Sat is the third goal. So what are the three different goals, Prabhuji?
Okay. Om is referring to the Supreme Lord. Tat is referring to the Supreme Abode. And Sat is referring to the devotees, sadhus. So that is how these are the three goals. Om is Supreme Lord, Tat is the Supreme Abode, and Sat refers to the devotees. sadhu, sadhu bhava.
So they are referred as a goal, huh?
They refer to goal.
I see. Fine. Okay, thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, on 23rd verse, it is first, but whether first class, second class, or third class, they all are conditioned, it is mentioned, I guess. If I'm not wrong, what Deepak Prabhu was asking, first class, second class, is it that?
No, in the other part, Prabhupada has mentioned first goal, second goal, and third goal. It's used that way.
Okay, Prabhu, I got it.
Hare Krishna. Am I audible now?
Yes, Prabhu.
Yes,
okay. So I'll just take very quickly questions. Today there are a lot of connectivity problem. Okay. So who was asking the question?
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu.
This whenever we do any charity or any activity, either it may be in fashion or in goodness, so what word we should be using, that Om Tat Sat or Om Tat Vishnu, I mean, to purify our consciousness, like.
So we can say Hari Om Tat Sat.
Hari Om Tat Sat.
This many devotees speak that, but also if we say, no, it is for the pleasure of Guru and Gauranga, that is also enough.
Okay, thank you.
Let it be for the pleasure of Guru and Gauranga. So we can do either of the things. Not a problem.
Achha, many times it is heard, Prabhuji, during charity it is said Krishna Arpan. Is it also equal?
It is also equal.
Fine.
The main thing is holy name of the Lord has to be there. At the same time, you have to remember that it is meant for the pleasure of Guru and Gauranga. That's all. So that is the basic purpose. Okay, so like sometimes Prabhupada would chant Om Tat Sat, but not always. I would rarely find. But then sometimes Prabhupada chanted, so we can also chant. It is recommended in the Bhagavad Gita. At the same time, no, every day we chant for the pleasure of Guru and Gauranga. Whenever devotees send email, they write, no, all glories to Guru and Gauranga, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. So there is something to remind us that everything is done for the pleasure of Guru and Gauranga. Just one last question by Ravi Prabhu. Yeah, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, actually, when we do charity, it is said that we should not publicize it. No, publicize. You know, we should not. We should not show that we have. You know, it should not be publicized. In the sense, it should be discreet. Correct, no, Prabhuji?
See, in general, when we give charity, it's better not to publicize. But let us say, if it is helping other people to get inspired, then we may do it.
Yeah, that's what my question was, Prabhuji. Actually, when we even give some donation to the temple, ISKCON temples also, the Prabhuji, you know, we when we insist also that we don't want the name, they say, no, it doesn't have any impact. You can always, they can put the name or something like that. You know, they say like that. Is it advisable or not advisable, Prabhu? Even though we say that, they said, no, it is good. You can put it like that, they were telling. Is it good or not, Prabhu?
It totally depends, Prabhuji. It totally depends on time, place, circumstances. If it is helping temple to collect more charity, then we may do that. But if it is not helping, then better go and put in the hundi and remain in the background.
Okay, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
So the purpose has to be known. Okay. Vinay Bhushan Ko and Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Pranams. In this shloka, Prabhuji, 26-27, it is written, Prabhuji, Sadbhava and Sadhu Bhava. So, this is Sadbhava is called acting in Krishna consciousness. Means the activities, what we do in goodness, we mean that, Prabhuji, in Sattva. Sattva means the mode of goodness.
See, actually, basically, when it is talking Sattva here, it's like talking to transcendence. Basically, it's Shuddha Sattva. It's not just referring to Sattva Guna. Okay, so it's Sadbhava, Sadhu Bhava. It's basically referring to transcendence. It's not talking to mental mode of goodness.
Okay. And Prabhuji, I have one more question. Prabhuji, see, means in this chapter, the last verse, Srila Prabhupada has stated that one has to do Krishna consciousness to transcend all the mode. This is the direct path. Then in our OBAs also we are writing, Prabhuji, like that, no, ki, how to be in mode of goodness, how you should practice mode of goodness in Krishna consciousness. Then what is the need, Prabhuji? Means my question is, if we are doing Krishna consciousness, then we don't need to acquire that mode of goodness or practice to be in the mode of goodness separately, no, Prabhuji?
See, if one can 24 hours be engaged in Krishna service, then there is no problem at all. So, but in general, we understand we can't be engaged in Krishna consciousness 24 hours a day. So then when we are not Krishna conscious, that time at least we should be in mode of goodness. By that, what happens is we don't fall down to mode of passion and ignorance because sins are committed in mode of passion and ignorance. So that is how mode of goodness helps. What I'll do is I'll send one article to our Anand Sesh Prabhu and he'll send you the article. So that article is written by Bhurujan Prabhu. So Bhurujan Prabhu quotes Prabhupada. So Prabhupada was telling, if they are so transcendental, then why are they falling down? That means they are not transcendental at that time. So then they should develop mode of goodness. So if we are in mode of goodness, then although we can chant 24 hours a day, we can't engage, have that consciousness of serving 24 hours a day, then what happens is at least at that time, if we are in mode of goodness, we will not incur sin. And like regarding Bhakti Charu Maharaj, when Prabhupada gave him sannyas, so many devotees had an objection. So they said that Prabhupada is a new man and why you're giving sannyas so quickly? because he came very late in Krishna consciousness in terms of Prabhupada's 11 years. So he came something like in 74 or 75. So Prabhupada very quickly gave him first initiation, second initiation, and very within 6 months, another 6 months, he gave him a sannyas. Many devotees had objection. So Prabhupada said, don't worry, even if he fall down, he will fall down to Mother Goodness. So what it means is, fine, he will not be remaining transcendental all the time. But if he remains in Mother Goodness, he will not incur sin. So that is how, you know, if we cultivate Mother Goodness, it helps us to transcend slowly. So we don't have to separately cultivate, but certain things we can do, like regulated life, sattvic food. So that helps us to remain away from material desires or desire for sense gratification. Passion means material desires. So then the struggle is less. Because unless until we come to the level of bhava, we are under modes. That's the truth. So let us be least bound by mode of goodness. Because we have to be bound anyway. Okay. Hari. Raghunandan Pu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Dhanavad Pranam. Prabhuji, just now you said that the donations maybe you can also give in, like what you can say, the Hundi and all. These donations, Prabhuji, we can give only thus within the four Sampradaya versus Kamsa temples, which is controlled by them. Or maybe you can also give the donations like some other Sampradayas, maybe like that, Prabhuji. Also, it's for good cause, we can give them.
The main thing is we have to see, is it helping people to come on the level of transcendence or not? Is it helping people to come closer to Krishna or not? If it is helping people to come closer to Krishna, then there is no problem. Let us say there is a particular place in a dham, Mayapur, Puri, and someone else is taken care. But if we know, if we give them money, or we help in constructing dham, it will help so many devotees to come and take darshan of the place. So then that can be done. That's not a problem in that. So ultimately, we have to see whether it is helping people to come closer to Krishna or not. If that is happening, then that should be done. Very simple formula. You are not audible, you are mute. You are mute, yeah.
Yes, sir. I have one more doubt. Just now you told to our the Mataji the questions because we are cannot able to always remembering Krishna's holy names and everything, and but we should be in the mode of goodness. So how we can be in the mode of goodness without doing thinking Krishna mantra, maybe in the Lord, in what way we can be in the mode of goodness provision? Like we can give some examples how we can be mode of goodness.
That's it, but I have a little ending.
I think Prabhu is not there. Hare Krishna Prabhu?
Here, in the Swami Patal Dani. At least. You put it up on me.
Sakhi Madhuri Mataji, your mic is on. Haribol, Sakhi Madhuri Mataji.
Now open your eyes slowly.
Prabhu, back.
No, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
So I would request devotees, I'll just give these three answers. If somebody has some questions, you can ask next time. Because it is unnecessarily wasting your time also. I am concerned about devotees. So I don't want that no, unnecessarily you waste time just waiting because of connectivity problem. So all these three devotees can ask questions, and later on we'll just switch off. So how do we cultivate mode of goodness?
Just when we're click on that mode of goodness, we can cultivate, though, because it's not possible for all the time be remembering and glorifying the Lord and doing activities. So how can be, in what way you can, in what type of example, if you can remember, how can be mode of goodness always?
Simple. When we eat food, we offer prasadam, but the modes also affect us. Although prasadam is transcendental. Let us say, if we eat a lot of chili, then automatically we get sweat in the forehead. We also get some anger, although it is prasadam. So prasadam cleanses the heart, but it affects our gross and subtle bodies. So let us honor prasadam in mode of goodness. Similarly, getting up early in the morning, sleeping early, another way. Third way is following cleanliness etiquettes properly. Keeping the place clean, cleanliness etiquettes. Like, no, we, whenever we for going toilet, no, we take bath. You go for clearing. So this is a cleanliness etiquette. So there are a lot of Vaishnava etiquettes like that. So by following Vaishnava etiquettes, so then these are different ways which we, in which we come to mode of goodness. Similarly, when we take wear clothes, so then it should be at least washed by water, at least. Better is to wash it with properly with surf and everything. But every day when we wear, don't wear the same clothes. General people outside have a culture. Same pair of clothes, no, they wear for 2 days, 3 days, 4 days. But Vaishnava etiquette is that we wear fresh clothes every day. So that is how that different ways are there. Okay. So they're limitless. And that needs whole training.
Yes. Sir. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Now, two more questions were there. Toshan Krishna, you had a question?
Yes, Prabhu, but not so important if you wanted to end the class.
Okay. No, you can ask, I think.
If connectivity
breaks, then we will not resume again. I'll just close it. Okay.
Okay. It's probably just a silly question, but I was just thinking when you were saying how we say in temple, all glories to assembled devotees. Recently, because of Corona, during Bhagavatam class, sometimes there's no devotees. And I was giving Bhagavatam class and there was no one there. So I didn't know after the kirtan to say all glories to assembled devotees, because there were no devotees assembled. It was only me.
No, so you can say like that. We can still say that, because there may not be devotees, there may be potential devotees. When you are speaking Bhagavatam class, there may be a lot of living entities in your room. They will get the benefit of hearing Krishna Katha. So they are potential devotees. And also, if you record the class you put in the internet or somewhere, then in the future somebody may hear it. It's an online class. Then also assemble devotees. Okay. So good. Okay. Very encouraging that, no, without audience you give class. It would happen to us in the early days. So we would have Bhagavad Gita class in our temple. Sometimes I would give class and nobody except the deities would be there. Even in class. So it was a real test, no, whether we have taste for speaking Krishna Katha or not. Very inspiring. Hari. Okay. Sipru had a question.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, this is about when we pray to others, whether it's non-devotees or devotees, what mode that is, does it come under? Bring their karmas to us?
Meaning praying for others.
So praying to others or praying for others?
Praying for others.
Praying for others, Prabhuji. Well, somebody has some problem and we say, hope they feel less pain.
Okay. So, see, one thing is our concept also has to be very clear that whether pain or pleasures, both of them are temporary. So let those things happen with the person that can bring him closer to Krishna. If a pain is going to bring someone closer to Krishna, let him have a temporary pain for having an eternal pleasure of being closer to Krishna. So this is something which we should understand. So then we should also pray in that terms only. that my dear Lord, whatever may happen with him, help him in such a way that he comes closer to you. That pain is a very good pain which can help one to come closer to Krishna.
Okay, Prabhuji, thank you. Prabhuji, I had one more question related to demigod worship. We pray Jagannath deities and we also have Subhadra Mai. How do we consider she's internal potency or superior, or should we think that she is Mahamaya? How?
Not Mahamaya, okay. She's Yogamaya.
Okay.
And we are seeing that she's sister of Krishna. Okay. So if you go to spiritual world, you see sister of Krishna there. Oh no, she has spiritual personality. So then it doesn't come in demigod worship.
Okay, Prabhuji. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. So we'll end here. So I'll try to find out the reason for irregular internet connectivity, and hopefully it will get resolved. And I request all the devotees who give presentations can mail me the PPTs. And we'll start from chapter number 18 in the next class. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki Shri Prabhupada ki Hare Krishna.